Today we are going to talk about antacids. Antacids are basically classified into systemic antacids and non-systemic antacids. Systemic antacids means which reaches the systemic circulation and produces systemic alkalosis. For example, sodium bicarbonate is a systemic antacid because it may get absorbed into the systemic circulation and it may cause systemic alkalosis. Non-systemic antacids like aluminium salts, magnesium salts and calcium salts. In aluminium salts, we have aluminium hydroxide, aluminium carbonate, magnesium salts like magnesium trisilicate, magnesium hydroxide, magnesium oxide, magnesium carbonate. In calcium salts, we have calcium carbonate. So these antacids, basically these gastric antacids are weak bases that reacts with hydrochloric acid. Or we can say drugs that neutralizes the gastric acid, we can call it as antacids. Antacids are weak bases that neutralizes gastric acid and raises the gastric pH. They do not affect the acid production. Basically, antacids are weak bases that neutralizes the gastric acid and increases the gastric pH or raises the gastric pH or elevates the gastric pH, or we can say it converts that acidic pH into the alkaline pH. Because there is a direct acid neutralization occurs. But one thing is important, they do not affect the acid production. There is no effect on the acid production. There is only acid base neutralization occurs, or we can say antacids are weak bases that neutralizes gastric acid and raise the gastric pH. Antacids adsorb the hydrogen ion and pepsin and provide relief from the pain. Sometimes antacids are given in combination with atropine to prolong the gastric emptying time. Antacids are given in combination with atropine to prolong the gastric emptying time, which increases the total buffering effect of antacids. Now we'll see sodium bicarbonate. The sodium bicarbonate is very effective and rapidly neutralizes gastric acid. It is very effective. But the problem with sodium bicarbonate, rapidly neutralizes gastric acid and it is very effective, but duration of action is very short. Means onset of action is very fast, rapid, but duration of action is very short. Means rapidly neutralizes hydrochloric acid. The disadvantage of sodium bicarbonate or NaHCO3, it is highly water soluble and it is rapidly absorbed from the gut. It is highly water soluble. The disadvantage of sodium bicarbonate, it is highly water soluble and rapidly absorbed from the gut. It releases carbon dioxide that can cause abdominal distension and belching. Means CO2 is released in the stomach, escape as a eructation or belching, and it may cause abdominal distension. And it is highly water soluble, that's why it will get absorbed from the gut or intestine, and it may cause systemic alkalosis. It may cause systemic alkalosis or metabolic alkalosis. It produces rebound acidity or hyperacidity. On repeated administration of sodium bicarbonate, it may cause rebound hyperacidity. Sodium load increases, or it may cause sodium retention, we can say. Sodium retention. So it should be avoided in patients with hypertension and congestive cardiac failure, because it may increase the sodium load, or we can say it should be avoided in patients with hypertension and congestive cardiac failure, as it causes sodium retention. It may also cause milk alkali syndrome. It may also cause milk alkali syndrome, in which there is a milk alkali syndrome, blood calcium level is increased. Blood calcium level is increased because of administration of dietary, administrations of calcium and sodium bicarbonate. It may lead to the milk alkali syndrome. Then where we use this sodium bicarbonate? Sodium bicarbonate we use in case of peptic ulcer and hyperacidity, we know that. And we also used in case of sodium bicarbonate is used to alkalize the urine and to treat the acidosis. It is also used for the alkalization of the urine and to treat the metabolic acidosis. Then aluminium salts as antacids, like aluminium hydroxide, aluminium phosphate. The main adverse effect observed with aluminium salts are constipation and phosphate depletion, or we can say hypophosphatemia, due to increased bone resorption, which may lead to osteomalacia. The constipation produced by aluminium salts can be avoided by concomitant use of diarrhea causing antacids like magnesium salts to nullify each other unwanted effects. Hence, combination antacid therapy is preferred. So most of the time aluminium salts are combined with the magnesium salts to nullify each other's adverse effects or unwanted effects. Dosing and adverse drug reaction. As per a dosing is concerned, there is no standard antacid doses in terms of tablet or syrup. At the same time, take as needed is clearly inadequate. Recommended liquid antacids may be taken 1 to 3 hours after meal or at bedtime. Antacid abuse means unnecessary use of antacids. It may lead to the antacid abuse. Then antacids do affect bowel motility and secretions. So it may also cause alkalurea, nephrolithiasis on chronic use, constipation, diarrhea, abdominal distension and flatulence. So basically, adverse drug reactions like magnesium salt, it may cause diarrhea. Aluminium salt like aluminium hydroxide may cause constipation and phosphate depletion. Calcium carbonate may cause hypercalcemia and hypercalciuria. Carbonate containing antacid like sodium bicarbonate, it may produce belching, eructations, abdominal distension. Carbonate containing antacids like sodium bicarbonate, it may produce belching, eructation, or there is a abdominal distension. Transient metabolic alkalosis and phosphate depletion or hypophosphatemia. Chronic antacid use may cause osteodystrophy, osteomalacia, proximal myopathy, and sometimes encephalopathy. Drug interactions like all antacid increases the pH of stomach. All antacids increases the pH of stomach, but there is no effect on the acid production. It forms non-absorbable complexes with many drugs like iron, tetracycline, fluoroquinolones, ketoconazole. So basically, if they form insoluble and non-absorbable complex with this drug, so they will reduce the absorption of all these drugs. So you have to avoid these drugs along with antacids, because it may form insoluble and non-absorbable complexes. Antacid reduces the absorption of tetracycline, phenothiazines, quinolones, digoxin, isoniazide, prednisolone, ranitidine, and fat-soluble vitamin. So basically, there is a chance of drug interaction. It may hamper or it may retard the absorption of all these drugs. So this interaction can be minimized by administering antacid with other drugs. Means there should be at least gap of 2 to 3 hours in between these two drugs. So calcium antacids when given with thiazide diuretics, it may cause hypercalcemia. And sucralfate should not be given along with antacid because it may hamper or it may retard the absorption of sucralfate. So this is all about the antacids. Thank you.